Good evening and welcome to tonight's meeting of the Commonwealth Clubs in Forum, a division of the club by and for people in their 20s and 30s with a mission to inspire debate on civic issues. The Commonwealth Club has recently launched our new In the Know campaign. Blind faith is truly blind. It's time to participate. If you repeat the arguments of the past, the arguments you hear from other people, you'll continue to live there. And we'd like to think that that stops today. So today, to be in the know, thank you for being here at the Commonwealth Club. To learn more, visit us at commonwealthclub.org/inform. My name is Jason Mark. I'm a writer and farmer, and this evening's moderator for our event, Millennial Changemakers. Tonight, our panelists are Erica Fernandez, a Stanford student and a grassroots organizer who is opposed to liquefied natural gas and pesticide spraying, Rachel Barge, the director and founder of Campus InPower, and May Boeve, the co-coordinator of 350.org. Each of these women are past winners of the Brower Youth Awards, which is, honors outstanding young environmental leaders. And I want to take a moment to share their accomplishments with you. At age 16, Erica Fernandez mobilized people in her community, youth, and other folks in the community to stop a multi-billion dollar plan liquefied natural gas plant off the coast of Oxnard, and also to stop pesticide spraying in her community. She's currently a sophomore at Stanford University, where she's majoring in urban studies and also spends part of her time volunteering at a continuing education high school. Rachel Barge is the program director of the Business Council on Climate Change, a member organization committed to reducing their emissions and promoting climate action in the private sector. Before that, she founded Campus InPower, which was working with activists across the country, and especially here in California. She'll be serving as a youth delegate at the Copenhagen climate negotiations. And May Boeve is the co-coordinator of 350.org, an international climate change campaign. Previously, May worked on the Step It Up campaign, which helped to change the debate about global warming policy in the US. So those are our distinguished panelists. Speaking of debate, let's get to it. So we're gonna just have a conversation here. And I guess one thing I'm really curious hearing from you guys, a year ago there was a lot of euphoria. Young folks, millennial age activists and voters were really instrumental in bringing Barack Obama into office and also strengthening a Democratic majority in Congress. A year later, how are you guys feeling, especially in regards to the environment? Do you think the Obama administration and the Congress have fulfilled the aspirations that a lot of young activists had during the campaign?
I can start. I read a quote today that said, it was a comment from a White House administration official who said, well, our job was like turning around an ocean liner. But in spite of, I think, a lot of the progress that's happened, I think we still have a long way to go. And my organization, 350.org, 350 stands for the safe level of carbon in the atmosphere. We're currently at a level above that, at 390 parts per million carbon dioxide. And we're working to try and really push the debate that's happening at the international level on climate change. And this is where we can see a lot more leadership from the Obama administration than I think we're currently seeing. I think there really is a leadership gap on this issue, at least from politicians. I think young people have really stood up to kind of take this issue on and change our campuses, change our communities, change our entire country. But I think we're waiting for a response from more from the White House. So that's my view, but I think Copenhagen doesn't kick off until December 7th, so there's still time to see tremendous amount of ambition coming from the Obama administration.
Yeah, and as a volunteer on the Obama campaign, I was definitely, you know, a part of that huge amount of momentum that young people felt, and really being at the inauguration later on and seeing the young people who had spent the last 2 years of their lives getting President Obama elected, it was just a really landmark moment. To what degree do we feel disappointed or, you know, by the progress that's been made? I think it's a bit of our generation really, you know, meeting that hard wall of political realities and the way that our political system has been constructed. And I don't know if I can speak for all the youth of America, but I certainly tuned out to a great degree during the Bush administration, just sort of wasn't involved in politics as deeply because I was so sort of alienated. And so with Obama, there was this big push for change, but now we're seeing a lot of the same tactics, the same vacuous political arguments, you know, not based on fact, you know, really being the foundation of the debates going on, whether it's climate change or whether it's healthcare. And so it's disappointing because we realized that we couldn't change our country just by changing our president, and one election wasn't going to fix everything, and some problems like, you know, gerrymandering in redistricting laws and all sorts of sort of symptoms that have caused our political system to be so polarized, I think, are very troubling to me. And I think it's going to take a lot of effort to sort of get our politics back to a debate where we're actually, you know, debating issues and we're debating facts and we're looking at what policies are best going to serve America. And it's not just which party is in power and the, you know, party that's not in power basically doing everything they can to block that party. It's disappointing, and I think a lot of young people, you know, it's troubling to see that that's the state of our country. But again, you know, we're still going to be out there fighting for the causes that we believe in.
I think I agree with May. I think we're living in a very wonderful time in our life where youth are mobilizing themselves to actually create change. And we might not see results from Obama as much as we wanted, but there's definitely a change. And I feel that there's a lot of people finding their voices with being inspired by him. I feel that I personally saw a lot of youth that you never see getting involved and actually finding their voice. And I feel that there is still a gap between, a disconnection between the people that are in power and the regular people. But I feel that little by little we're getting closer, where we all thinking in the same that there's things that we forgot that we need to bring back and actually start taking action, because I think nature is telling us, you know, you pretty much screwed me up. I need your help. And I feel that when nature is telling us that, I feel that that's when people are going to wake up and realize that there's something that we're going to do. Either is Obama the person that does it, or is either us, the people that are here, but someone has to do it. And I feel that if we are talking about it, that's already a step.
So, Erica, you said that, you know, nature is sending us a message. And I think the perception out there is that, well, young people will say, like, younger than, let's just say 34, are among the more environmentally aware and engaged. And do you guys think that's true, and why do you think that's true? I mean, you guys seem proof positive of that, but when you're looking around your peers, does it seem to you that younger people are more concerned about ecological sustainability than, say, your parents might be or other folks you know?
Absolutely. I think it's a real generational shift. I think part of it, there just wasn't much of a social expectation for young people my parents' age when they were going off, and it was just, you know, get an education, get a job, start a family. There wasn't much of a greater consciousness. You know, women's rights was a big issue of the day. I myself can definitely say that I'm a product of environmental messaging of the late 80s and early 90s. I really resonated with seeing, you know, the rainforest being destroyed or things like that, and it just caused me to think sort of outside of myself and where I was at that point. And I also think, you know, we've laid the foundation and the groundwork of scientific studies, of organizations looking at this, of the environmental movement being out there for enough time, that we're really getting the information back and saying, oh my, like, we don't have a very large sample size, but the results are precipitous. You know, sea turtles with a 90,000, you know, breeding female population 20 years ago, now at 2,000 individuals. That's not, you know, that's a big indicator of change. And so, with more information, more transparency, the internet, media, you know, more people are becoming aware. Young people are very plugged into media. And I think they are just ripe to sort of receive that information and to feel compelled to do something. You know, I also think our own sort of affluence and our ability to sort of navigate our future also plays into our role as pursuing environmental causes. And again, I'm sort of speaking for the particular community that I've organized in. But I think if I was out there having to pay off, you know, $90,000 student loans, I don't think that I'd be working for, you know, a small stipend of grant money to, you know, to support myself. I think I'd be looking for a job that could help me, you know, get ahead financially. So a lot of the folks that are fighting this cause have, you know, honestly are like privileged to be able to be doing that. And they feel, you know, that they have a role to give back in that way.
Yeah, I would add too that I think part of it is having a broader global consciousness as well. I think it's not just about the environment per se, it's about our role in the world and how young people interact with people around them, and that we're not living our own isolated lives, and it's not just about sort of me moving forward. I think that, you know, we grew up in a time when you couldn't turn around without a reminder that we were living in kind of a globalized world, and with social media and with Facebook and a lot of the ways people are connecting not only to people on their campus but people halfway around the world online, you can't ignore the implications of your actions, I think. So I think this actually gives me a lot of encouragement, is how globalized and aware our generation is. It'll be interesting to see as we kind of move into positions of, I'll say that for the radio, quote, political leadership, because I think a lot of us are leading. But is this going to direct the way we make policy differently? And my sense is that it is. I think this broader sense of solidarity with people in other parts of the world will change the way young people approach some of the issues that we inherited. And I think the environment is a large part of that, but it fits in a whole context of social issues.
One of the things that I always share when I go and speak with youth and adults, it's always say that the idea that everything we do, it's affecting the person next to us directly or indirectly. And I feel that I started in being an organizer or in the environmental movement when I was 12, right after I came from Mexico. I didn't know the language and things like that, but I knew something was wrong. I knew that I needed to go to the beach and clean up the beach if I wanted to have a safe environment. And at that point, it was only me and the other people were adults taking the responsibility to teach the youth. And by the end, when we stopped this multi-billion dollar corporation, you could see the difference that the majority were youth taking action. And you see that difference when the people, older people, are empowering the younger people to work together because they realize that we are interconnected, that whatever they're doing, it's affecting us, and things that we could do to help, it's gonna have a greater impact. And that's when I see, I think, that the role that youth has now these days, because they're becoming more empowered, and now they believe that they have a voice, that they believe that if they take a time to step and volunteer to do something in the environment, they will do it. And especially right now, I'm volunteering in this continuation high school, and what I'm doing there, it's a continuation high school with students who were, for some reason, were not able to graduate from a normal high school, but these students are the pioneers of a new revolution, because they're have their own organic garden, they're growing their own food, and they're selling it to the flea market. They also have a creek next to their high school. They're using the creek to test the water. They're every day they learn something new about global warming. And when you ask them, what is something, if there was something that you could do now, what would you do? And most of the answers were, stop climate change, stop global warming. And when you have a group of high school students thinking about these issues, you already are creating change, because before we didn't have those kind of dialogues. And I feel that these students, when they're planting a tree or something, they go back and realize and teach their parents that there's something they could do to make a difference. And I feel that now at this moment, we're experiencing this time where youth and adults are working together for a better planet.
So Rachel, you said something I kind of want to come, I think it was you or somebody, or May said, talked about the recession and how it's, you know, it's not the shiniest economy out there. If you're just getting out of college, say, if you're 22, 23 years old and you're getting out of college, there's not a whole lot of job prospects. So is that, you think, helping or hurting? Does it foster or does it sort of retard the creation of a youth environmental movement in terms of, okay, there might not be as many opportunities for people, so what are they going to do instead? And then are they discouraged about being able to take the time out to say to work on the environment or work on other issues because they're so busy just trying to make ends meet?
Yeah, it's absolutely the worst economy that a young person could ever get placed into coming straight out of college. Most of the young people that I know who have just graduated are definitely unemployed with no good prospects, so I'm not going to paint a rosier picture with that being the foundation, but I'm very inspired by young people who are taking this sort of crisis and turning it into an opportunity. And young people are just realizing, like, that job that's going to be sitting on some job posting out there just isn't going to exist for me. And if it does, there's going to be 500 people that are applying for it. And if my resume even gets a look, like, that'd be great. So they're saying, well, I'm going to have to start creating a job for myself. And I'm I came out of the campus activism movement. I was very active at the UC Berkeley campus. I helped establish a $2 million sustainability fund while I was there. That's sort of why I got the Brower Youth Award. And what I did is after I graduated, I founded a nonprofit consulting firm to spread the funding model that I had helped create on my campus to other campuses. And I got grant money to support myself to do that. So I basically made a job for myself my year after college. And I can tell you, I was absolutely a more prepared candidate for this economy, having, you know, run an organization completely by myself, you know, built my own website, built a listserv, you know, done trainings all over the country, you know, made the content. I had to wear a lot of different hats and be kind of, you know, scrappy in how I made that job for myself. But the skills and the knowledge that I learned in just navigating my campus while I was a student, and then really studying campus organizing the year afterwards, I think made me, you know, I had solar companies coming up to me and saying, you know, we'd really love to have you come and advise our campus engagement strategy because we really want to push solar on college campuses. And I don't think most students who go to the environmental club as a freshman like are really thinking that they're going to learn their job skills doing that. But I think increasingly we need to have our students getting real world hands-on, I call them 21st century educations, you know, real experiences. And I think students have absolutely been creating that for themselves. You know, the Energy Action Coalition sent 15,000 young people from all over the country to Washington, D.C. this year. Those kids are going back to their campuses and creating these systems. I'm really happy to say that last Friday I was back at campus attending a gala for students who had received $91,000 of the fund that I had helped create when I was a student to create their own student-run food cooperative that's all locally sourced food straight from the farms. The students work on the farms, they prepare the food, they sell the food, they manage the co-op. It's a fully run business. They actually need $300,000 to make this happen, so that's why they're having a benefit gala. But I was just blown away that you know, that we're, our activism builds on itself, and we're sort of creating this new economy from the ground up. And so that's what gives me hope in the face of this, the current job market and what young people are facing.
So I guess nobody else is able to, but you're lucky. You're still in school, right? You've got two more years to start thinking about that. I do want to come back to something, May, you were talking about earlier, which is, you know, how much, especially 350.org and the Step It Up campaign, which have been, you know, really incredible examples of using online media and using the web to knit together people, first in Step It Up's case across the country, and then in 350.org's case across the world. For, you know, action on the climate. But one thing that a lot of people confront in terms of the activism world is how do you get people who go from online activism to actually doing things off of the computer screen? And I'm wondering how you guys have overcome that challenge, given that a lot of the people you might be organizing are hyper, let's say, wired in, right? They're on their iPhones all the time, or on, you know, Facebook all the time, or Twittering all the time. And so what are the challenges, and how have you guys overcome the challenges of getting people to go from their computers and then take real world actions?
Yeah, it's a really good question, and I think it's often brought up. Thomas Friedman's written about this a lot, like Facebook activism, and what is that really contributing to the broader social good? But I think that was exactly the critique that we wanted to upturn with our organizing. The Step It Up campaign was an effort to help kind of jumpstart and spark a grassroots movement in the U.S. around climate change and knit together a lot of the existing efforts, but make it really visible. And so April 14th of 2007, we helped organize 1,400 rallies around the country in every state, and they all had the same message, which was Step It Up, Congress, cut carbon 80% by 2050. And this helped immediately kind of put that target in the center of the political debate. And it's still the top line goal of the Obama administration. It continues to be debated within the Senate. But our effort there was exactly to try to see if we could test this idea. Will people take online action offline? And what we've been able to see is the web is a great motivator for connecting people together, but enabling people to learn about ways to take action locally and learn about how they're connected to people in other parts of the world and other parts of the country. So I actually think coupled together, online and offline action are changing the world. I think that's what we're seeing right now and what's happening all over the place. I think one of my favorite examples is, you know, with our 350 campaign, we had just come off of this Step It Up organizing model, which worked in the U.S., and we thought, oh, why not take it globally, which is kind of an insane idea for a group of seven people to think that this is at all possible.
But well, there's seven continents, so you just split it up.
That's,
you
know? That's exactly what we did. In fact, that was exactly the plan. And but it was really an experiment. Will this idea take off if we put up a website, we get this concept up online? And it really did take off in unbelievable ways. And last October 24th, there were events in 181 countries around the world. And it started with a spark of this idea online. And so that's not to at all, you know, reduce the fact that people that was very much enabled by traditional organizing, of people going door to door and putting up posters and handing out leaflets. But the web enables people in Bahrain and Ethiopia and the United States and Mexico to be sharing the same thing at the same time. And so that, to me, has tremendous potential for what we're all trying to do in our own work and in kind of remaking the world in a different way. But I think that we're able to use the web in fantastic ways. I mean, I know this whole conversation is being tweeted right now, and so I think it's just adding a new dimension to activism. I think it's very exciting, and I'm excited to see kind of what the next big online campaign ends up being.
Personally, I do the old-fashioned kind of thing. I like to go and actually have interaction with people and actually get hands-on things. Especially, I think I feel that when you get yourself in front of a person and realize, put yourself there and you tell them, this is the reason why I'm doing it. I need your help. I feel that there's that interaction where you are putting yourself out there and say, we have to work together. For me, organizing my community against this multi-billion dollar corporation, it was a wonderful experience. But I think other than beating this company, it was the idea of these people finding their voices. And now there's so many other things going on in that community that they're working, that they're organizing, that they're taking the time to knock those extra doors, because a lot of these communities, they are not educated. They cannot use a computer. So you have to also think of those people, that they have a lot of potential getting the voice out there, that it haven't yet been exposed to the internet. And also you have the other hand that they could do that. So I think when you combine people who are willing to take the time and talk directly to people, to the internet, where you can connect people from all over the world, you can actually like make the change much alive. I feel that when you put yourself out there, the message gets stronger because you're taking the time to do it and make it happen.
And I would just like to make a point about sort of what I see as the philosophy that kind of drives 350.org's online organizing, because I think online organizing is sort of this big general term, but I think they've done an exceptional job of implementing. And we wouldn't have had actions in 181 countries all over the world if the call had been, you know, get everyone to sign this petition and click send, you know, or like reformat this email and click send, or, you know, a lot of the sort of very like single action, just digitize behind the screen, you're done types of things. What 350 asks people to do is get out into their community, rally with existing groups on the ground. 350 approached those groups on the ground and said, we're here to support you. We're a resource for you. We want to make your voice stronger. We want to empower you and give you a global stage to stand on. You know, we're going to give you all the resources you might need, but we welcome anything that you're bringing to the table. And, you know, this is going to be a real live human interaction, community building thing that's going to really actually galvanize any local issues that you're working on. But it's, again, going to have a global, you know, synchronized message. So I think, you know, online organizing that involves empowerment, empowering individual, unique, creative action that's not just a single form of action that everyone must comply with uniformly, I think that's a really key ingredient. I also think, obviously, having community and really respecting the needs of local communities, local groups, respecting their autonomy, and approaching it from like a mutually beneficial relationship, not just, we need you to go out and get this number of signatures, this number of campaign metrics. It's really something where it's like, hey, we all have this same common goal. We could be much more powerful together, and we're going to do this in a way where, at the end of the day, we both feel really proud, and we both accomplished a lot. So I really admire their organizing, and I think folks that kind of pioneered maybe original online organizing can really learn from young people who sort of bring these values, where they want to make sure that people feel empowered and they feel creative and unique in what they're doing, because that's sort of the key, I think, to getting people, like you said, behind the screen and actually out in the streets or skiing down mountains or, you know, scuba diving under the reefs, which is what people did for 350.org. So.
And Rachel, you were talking about, you know, respecting communities, and Erica, you were talking about helping communities find their voices, which brings up the other point that not only is, I guess, what you could call the Obama generation, but Generation Y among the most ecologically aware and engaged, but also among the most ethnically diverse. Yet historically, the environmental movement definitely has this reputation for being, you know, very white, or at least very white run. And so, you know, what are some of the work that you guys have done personally, or some of the challenges, again, you've tried to address in terms of ensuring that as you're organizing with your peers, that the environmental movement reflects the diversity of you know, this country, and especially how that's going to change?
I have to say that a lot of times I'm in that room and I'm the only one that looks brown or that is color, you know, and I feel sometimes you feel that you are by yourself in the movement, that there's not, you don't have people who are backing you up. But I feel that it has become, I think more, now it's more common to see more people. I feel that they're in different places in the United States finding their voices and actually taking action. I feel that when I go and speak to high school students who the majority are minority, it's the message is different when you speak to someone who's already in power and know about the environmental issues. I think you're just working with different, I think with different groups of people, and you have to make sure that the way you address them is to empower them and not to push them down. Because they do, I think they still get that message that the only that middle class white people are in the top of the environmental movement. But in reality, I think it's becoming more diverse, and I think there's more women in power. I feel that this is an example. I feel that women are taking action now, that they're finding their voices and they're willing to step up and bring more minorities to their group. And it makes us, I think, the message so much bigger when you don't see the same group of people at the same meetings all the time. You also see different voices, different. I say it because when I organize, I help organize the community, over 3,000 community members, in front of people who were gonna vote or enlisting the land or not to this corporation, you could see who were in the power and who's the people behind this, like down on the stage. On the scenario or the audience, and you realize that it, at that point it didn't matter what language you speak or what ethnicity you were, they were all together for the same reason. And I feel that now the planet doesn't discriminate, the planet doesn't have any barriers, and it's affecting us all. And I think we have to understand and be more conscious that whatever we do, either directly or indirectly, is affecting the person next to us.
Yeah, I agree with Erica, and I think this idea is also completely broadening who's getting, as Erica said, who's getting involved in the environmental movement. And just to talk about Copenhagen for a second and the international climate negotiations happening there in a few weeks, it's you know, in some ways it's a climate change meeting that's about a climate change agreement, but it's becoming a meeting about human rights and about climate justice and about trade barriers and about a lot of issues that matter to a lot of people. And it's really creating a much more diverse movement on the global level. And I think a lot of people are learning from each other, from experiences and, you know, community struggles in places like Indonesia, where there are palm oil plantations that are really damaging local communities. And there are, you know, Indonesian youth who are educating American youth who are learning about environmental justice in their own communities. So I think we all are learning a lot from each other about how to make this movement much more, to really value its inherent diversity. And I think that's Jason's point. You know, we are a diverse generation, but are we truly working together? And I think that's been something that the youth climate movement has really tried very hard to fundamentally address, to take very seriously, and I think we're making strides. I think we have a long way to go. But it's been, you know, I got involved in the climate movement when I was in college a few years ago, and there was a lot of really rich discussion about how do we change the composite of people in this room in our meeting. And that's really, I think it's made a big impact in terms of who's involved and the different perspectives that people are learning from.
So Erica, you said that the planet doesn't discriminate, and the planet also doesn't discriminate, you know, when ecosystems are collapsing, when the ocean is losing its biodiversity, climate change is obviously a global threat. And a lot of you guys, you know, obviously May, but I think also Erica, and I don't know, Rachel, maybe you could tell me a little bit about this, have worked with allies, with peers in other countries. So do you guys see, and again, I'm not asking you to be the voice of American youth and green activists, but from your perception, does it feel to you that people in other countries are, in general, more environmentally sophisticated or more committed to these issues? I mean, because the global perception is, well, the U.S. is always lagging. The U.S. is lagging in Copenhagen, and the U.S. is lagging with the Montreal Protocol, and all these sorts of other different things. But does it seem to you that way from the grassroots?
I took a bit of a lesson from my friend Carolyn Howe, who drove a biodiesel van and solar-powered car across India, building the youth climate movement in India. And I was just surprised at sort of her discovery that these students were just as passionate and just as interested and excited about solutions to climate change and about, you know, solving environmental problems in their country. But they're competing. If we talk about our job market being difficult to compete in, you look at India, it's nearly a billion people, you know, competing for spots in these universities. You ask a university student, hey, are you going to spend your evening going to an organizing meeting and maybe making some banners to do an event? No, they need to focus on their engineering degree. So what she learned is that they ended up sort of tying some of the activism to, you know, clean energy innovation contests in which the students would be awarded a certificate at the end and be, you know, have an opportunity to bring that technology further along in their university studies or maybe for a job after graduating, and that they sort of just had to approach it based on the needs of the folks in those communities and discover that, you know, once they could meet their need for achieving success and, you know, raising a family with a good wage that they were just as passionate, they just didn't have necessarily the affluence that a lot of my collegiate peers here in the U.S. have to sort of, you know, wander through college and spend their time organizing freely and then, you know, hope that it works out in a job at the end. But I think there are those carrots, there's those incentives for all sorts of folks all over the world. Like May was saying, in Indonesia, it's about, you know, we rely on this rainforest and we rely on our groundwater and on our environmental quality for, you know, our very survival. So we're absolutely going to be committed to it. So it's going to be a different mixture depending on what, you know, country and what region you're looking at. But
yeah, I also think one other major incentive for people getting involved is how palpable climate change impacts are in a lot of parts of the world. And that's been something that has been a huge education for us as we've been trying to figure out, well, how do we connect with activists in Laos, which is some of the questions we have in the office on a regular basis. And, you know, in Southeast Asia last year in Vietnam, 1/5 of the rice crop was wiped out because the monsoon pattern has changed. And it's fundamentally impacting the way people are living their lives. And so, and there's a rich culture of political organizing in a lot of these countries. And so a lot of people are starting to take a lot of action on environmental issues. So we're meeting an incredible amount of young people around the world. And by meeting, I mean often we're interacting with them through email and online. But who are really taking leadership and who are seeing environmental issues as a way to kind of move a democratic movement in some of their countries, like youth in China, youth in Vietnam, and Cambodia, who see environmental issues as kind of a safe space where they can organize. And there's a lot of really exciting action happening in places where other kinds of political protests are discouraged and unsafe. So I think that's been really eye-opening for me to observe. And one other example of kind of how surprising it is to learn about these actions that are happening is we helped organize a training in Johannesburg a few months ago for youth throughout Southern Africa who were interested in studying the environment in school. And these two young women, two sisters from Addis Ababa, Ethiopia, came to the training and were really interested in organizing one of these events for this day of action I was talking about. And they went back to Addis Ababa and we didn't really hear too much from them. And then 2 days before this International Day of Action, they called us and they said, oh, we have 15,000 school children who are going to march in the streets in Addis Ababa on October 24th. And it was kind of a shaky connection on Skype. And we said, did you say 15,000 school children in Addis Ababa? And these two young women had gone to every school in Addis Ababa and given a presentation about climate change and this 350 target and what it means. and they had half of the students of all of the schools in all of Addis Ababa come out to this protest, and they all were holding 350 signs, and they all knew what that meant, and this really kind of just shocked everybody, I think, and it shocked CNN, and it shocked the BBC, that they said, wow, okay, this global climate movement really is different people. It's not what we expect from the environmental movement, and that was, you know, I had friends asking me, like, okay, so what were those 350 signs really about? Was this like a different event and you handed people 350 signs? I said, no, everybody in this protest knew what this is about. And so that's one example, one of the really stunning ones to me, but of how this is happening around the world.
For me, I had the opportunity to go back to Mexico and speak about my work in the United States, coming from Mexico and then going back. It was a different experience, and I never expected the government of Veracruz, which is one of the states that it's next to the coast that would be having a lot of problems with hurricanes if the sea levels rises with climate change. He had organized 4,000 youth from Veracruz, and to have 4,000 youth in the same place in Mexico, that's a big accomplishment, especially if the government is taking the time and the resources to do it. And for me to go back and to see them together and to see them empowered and to see them aware of the potential that they could bring to the movement, it was amazing. And the reason I share it is because these 4,000 youth were talking about things that they were doing, picking either computers in the water or all this trash that was in their water, or even recycling, or even things that for them, they're already environmentalists since they are born, because there's not a lot of resources and they just have to live with what they have, and there's not a lot of materialism or consumption, you know. They barely have enough to survive, and for them to think about the things that they could do to help those people like us that we consume as crazy, that we pollute as crazy, and to know that Mexico is not one of the biggest polluters, and yet they're thinking about how can we help our neighbor country to reduce the amount of pollutants? How can we help the other people around the world to start thinking about how can we stop this extraction for our planet? And I think for them to do it even before other people tell them to do, it's a big change. Especially for me, it was an eye-opening to know that in my country, I'm seeing that change. And for me to go back and to see that there's a lot of potential there as an environmentalist, it really made a big impact in my life. And I can say that they're ahead and they're trying. I went back this summer to Mexico City and to talk to different colleges and to talk about climate change, and to know that they already knew what's going on, and to know that they were already hosting all these coalitions where they were talking about the environment and how can we work together to help it. It really made a big difference, and to know that even that United States could have an impact in other places for something good rather than to pollute more, I feel. It was a great feeling.
You know, that Addis Ababa story kind of brings to mind how, you know, when you talk about youth activism, you sometimes get the response of, oh, kids say the darndest things, don't they? You know, and it's kind of can sometimes be a little condescending. So in your efforts, whether it's, you know, around the LNG plant in Oxnard or campus power or with 350.org and Step It Up, have you ever encountered sort of from maybe you know, just older people, from elders, from older activists, that sort of condescension, and how have you sought to, you know, address that and just sort of go beyond it? Maybe you haven't. Maybe you guys just knock
absolutely.
Everybody's socks
I'm
off.
Like,
I don't know.
Which example should I give? I think, like I said, I honestly feel that there's a lot of philosophical differences with the young people approaching organizing in these issues, and I find them to be very compelling. I think we're not proprietary-based. We're not saying, I'm going to go out only if my brand is on this, and if only my resources are directed there, and I'm not really willing to work with other people to get it done. I was really surprised to be sitting in a meeting here in the Bay Area of kind of a coalition of nonprofits that have some kind of stake in Copenhagen. And it was my first meeting, and this sort of older organizer woman started introducing like what this group was all about. And she saying, oh, you know, we're working on Copenhagen solutions. And, you know, we kind of heard that there's this sister, you know, organization, same kind of coalition popping up in D.C., but don't we know that we're so much better than D.C. and we're, you know, we're going to show them that San Francisco is the real center of environmentalism. And like a lot of people in the room were like snapping and like really applauding this on. And like, I was looking at May being like, really? Like, we're not going to work together with the D.C. people? Like, that seems like that would be a good idea. And just kind of, again, this very, like, total egoless sort of commitment to the cause and the issue and saying, I'm going to do whatever it takes to get it done. And it's not about me. It's not about my brand. It's about the solutions and implementing them. I think that's really exciting. And, you know, a big part of my job with Campus InPower was advising college students when their administrators were going to say no at every single avenue and every single turn. And no matter how many cost-benefit assessments and, you know, reports they could put in front of them that says, this is how much money you will save doing energy efficiency. This is how much money will go back into your operating budget. This is how much donation dollars that we can project are going to come into the university coffers because we can put environmental initiatives on our donation material. And still saying, that's just not how we do things around here. And sorry, kid, go home and do your homework. It's just a very prevalent issue for young people. And I don't know. I mean, honestly, for me, you know, kind of winning the Brower Award and sort of stepping into a higher circle of activism for me at that point in my life kind of was an empowering experience because I said, you know, oh, here's, you know, people twice my age who are saying, your work is legitimate. You know, the work that you did is valuable to society. I didn't do it because I wanted to, like, win some award or have my brand go out there. I just did it because I felt that, you know, Berkeley shouldn't continue to have a larger carbon footprint than the nation of Cambodia. Like, I thought that was a bad idea, and that the students should try to do something to reduce the carbon footprint of Berkeley, because Cambodia is a nation of 13 million people, and Berkeley has, like, 40,000 students. So, you know, I was out there just sort of, again, I think a lot of us are just doing it because we feel incredibly called, and we're going to work together and try to find the solution, so.
For me, I had an experience with, after stopping the corporation, we moved to the next environmental injustice issue that we had in that community, because I don't know if I, let me just describe how that community at Oxnard, we have two power plants, we have a Superfund site, which is a toxic site, there next to the beach, and then we had this proposed liquefied natural gas facility in the same place, and then we are surrounded by agricultural fields all around the city. So it cannot get worse than that when you're breathing pesticides and when you're breathing pollutants every day. So after we stopped this corporation, we wanted to clean up the Superfund site that is there. And because it has been there for 40 years, it's increasing the levels of cancer of the community that are living next to it. And I have to say, it's only feet away from the beach where people go and go to the water, and we have the last natural wetlands next to it, and it's a lot. There's a lot of issues, so we wanted to clean it. So we were trying to work together with the city officials to start that process so that the EPA would come and clean it. And I remember we had this coalition where the youth took over the stage, and they were guiding the meeting, and the city officials were sitting in the front row, and it seems that the mayor didn't like it. They didn't like that the people on stage were the community people asking them to hold him accountable. And one of the things that he mentioned is that he would have preferred go to see a soccer game of his sons rather than go take the time so that they can clean up that Superfund site. And I think when you find your city officials doing that, then what else could you do? If they're the people who are representing you for in front of the government and things like that, then what do you expect? So I feel that when there's this disconnection between the people in power with the common people, something's wrong. And I feel that if the city official at that point wanted the best for the city, he would say, I can take the time, I will hold myself accountable, I will hold the Congress people accountable so that we can all work together to clean this site. Even though he didn't respond right at that time, now he's helping us to clean up the site. I think we're in the second stage. We've been working with, we work with Obama's transition staff, with Congress people, and trying to clean up the Superfund site, which would be the first one of the 260 sites to be clean if it follows through. And we're making sure that it follows through. So
Just want to let you know, as a reminder to our audience, this program is presented by the Commonwealth Clubs and Forum, and tonight we're hosting Millennial Changemakers with Erica Fernandez, Rachel Barge, and May Boeve. I want to invite the audience to have some questions. So if you do have any questions for these distinguished activists, please line up at the microphone over there, and we'll take some of your questions. In the meantime, though, I do have a question, which is that, you know, I think often younger social change advocates have something of a reputation for being impatient, right? I mean, that's part of the thing of youth, and it's like, here we are, and we want to see this change. And yet, listening to you guys seem, I mean, you're very reasonable, and you're very nice and polite. And so I'm kind of wondering where the radicals are. Or maybe they just don't get invited to the Commonwealth Club. I don't know. I mean, do you think that there's something a little bit different in this social change movement than maybe what people's stereotype is of social change in terms of maybe these leftover ideas from 60s or 70s movements, et cetera?
Well, I think those radical voices are still all over the youth movement, and I think what the youth movement is effectively doing is, as I was saying before, sort of embracing all the different perspectives. And so I think this coalition that Rachel mentioned, the Energy Action Coalition, is a group that a lot of us work with, and I see a lot of nods in the audience about people kind of being familiar with what they've done. And this is a coalition of, I think at this point, about 45 organizations throughout the country and in the U.S. and Canada that work on climate change. And this stems from groups like the Sierra Club's youth arm to the Rising Tide Collective, which is a more radical group that's, you know, does a lot of civil disobedience and direct action. And all these youth are working together, and they're sort of sharing their own strategies. So I think that I think we do have an edge. I think we also want to make sure that we're working on multiple levels, because what we've seen from the past is whatever was happening, we have not solved our environmental problems. And so we need new tactics, and we need to embrace a lot of different types of tactics. And so I think that, a good example of this was back in March for the Power Shift Conference. This was the training where 12,000 youth were in Washington, or 15,000. Many, many youth were in Washington doing this incredible training. And then as soon as that ended, there was this civil disobedience action at the coal plant that powers the U.S. Capitol. And this was, a great example of how, you know, youth that morning did a lobby day on Capitol Hill wearing ties and green hard hats, and then that afternoon they marched to the coal plant. And I think that this is how the movement is evolving. I think we're learning from each other. We're being strategic about having, you know, a left flank and a policy arm, and we're trying to use these tactics. So I certainly feel like the radical part of the youth movement is alive and well.
With the pragmatists.
Right.
They don't split into separate camps, I think.
Yeah, so I think it's a healthy collaboration that's happening, and I'm excited to see what's coming next.
I think we still have a little bit of that radical, because that's what keeps us going. I feel that we need to be able to wake up in the morning and say, continue, it's time to continue and to not give up. And I feel that we have changed from the activist who would be in the streets yelling to the activist that takes that time, educates himself or herself, and actually educates others to bring together and actually organize and take action and creating coalitions and from their movements and creating a big, big impact in our lives.
We've got a question from the audience. Yes, sir.
Yes. I'm tremendously encouraged to hear from people like yourself and everything that's gone on this year on this. I'm not so encouraged when I look at the Senate and particularly regarding Copenhagen. They've already said, we're not going to get a binding agreement. We're going to kick that down the road. So I just want to hear from you, after Copenhagen happens, and I'm sort of seeing the inevitable stories in the press of failure at Copenhagen, how do you, continue to forward this message that, hey, we're not going away, there's a lot to happen beyond Copenhagen, and what comes next?
Yeah, well, I think you definitely hit the point where these are stories in the press. These are stories in the press. And there's a lot happening at Copenhagen that's beyond just binding mitigation targets. Mm. There are many different policy tracks that are getting addressed. We're looking at deforestation policy. We're looking at tech transfer policy. We're looking at how do we, fund clean development in developing countries. I went to a training in DC for 3 days and got like the bullet points, overarching notes of what's going on in Copenhagen. Like, there you couldn't even expect the media to really communicate the depth of what's going on. And so it is disappointing that we're sort of getting this broad-based message that's like, oh, it's all lost, like all the buildup is for nothing. The State Department coming out and saying, oh, we couldn't have possibly negotiated something in 22 days. It's like, you've been working on that for 2 years. You're working on that for 20 years. It's not, we're seizing that moment because it's the convenient thing to say because, in reality, Obama probably couldn't have gotten compelling climate legislation passed at the same time he was doing healthcare. And unfortunately, a lot of people have chosen to spin climate negotiations based on, the U.S.'s participation. But I'm sure May can go into a lot better detail than I can just on how the complexity of those relationships and what really can be accomplished with broad-based coalitions with and without the participation of the U.S. And I think fundamentally, I haven't been a participant before, but I went to trainings with lots of young people who participated in Poznan and Bali. And, our head negotiator under Bush was an oil lobbyist. That's different now. Like, that's a big difference. You can't really describe how just the way the game has changed, just having Obama and the regard that he has in the globalized world and, his commitment to climate. So, no, he couldn't agree. He didn't want to repeat Kyoto and, sign something and have the Senate not ratify it for political reasons. But, I'm very confident that the U.S. is going to be a strong player. So, but it took even me, I had to go around and educate myself when this news came out and say, really? Like, is this really, should I not go anywhere? Not that I was thinking that, but, it is really shocking to see these very, black and white portrayals that we see in the media. And I think it's just hard because I don't enjoy reading massive long emails and tons of blog posts about climate policy. I'm a skimmer, so I had to go through and just spend that couple of hours getting the story for myself. And I'm sure May can expand on that because she's really working at the international level for many years now. But
no, I totally agree with what Rachel was saying. And I think there's a few other things to add. And this is, I think, where the youth are radical is, failure is not an option for these negotiations. I think that's something that we know to be true. And we have an incredible ally in the 93 countries who are at the United Nations who also know this is true because their islands are going underwater or they have completely arid fields and, where they're going back to negotiate, or excuse me, where they're going back to live. And so I think that there's a very encouraging alliance happening between youth from around the world and a lot of political, unlikely allies, political leaders from other countries who are standing up and saying, no, we don't want to sign on to another international agreement when our very survival is on the line. And so I think that, we're seeing leadership from people like the president of the Maldives, President Mohamed Nasheed, who said, we're going to aim to make our country carbon neutral to kind of shine a light to how this can really happen and truly lead. And the Maldives, the highest point on the island is a few meters above sea level. Like, they are literally going underwater now, and the sheet isn't saying, it's already happening. He's saying, okay, well, we're going to reduce our own tiny, tiny blip of emissions. And so that I think is a source of encouragement that this political pressure is happening. I agree with you that the U.S. Senate needs to feel the heat, and I think that a lot of people are thinking along these lines, but there's, a handful of individual people who have such a say over the lives of billions of others. It's shocking. And so we, as people who live in the United States, and even us here in the Bay Area, we have very influential senators who could be doing more on this issue. That there's unquestionably, Senators Boxer and Feinstein are leaders, but there's more that they could do. And so I think that's another, to me, another source of encouragement is we can be at their offices more. I know there's going to be on December, the night of December 11th, a candlelight vigil in front of our senators' offices here in San Francisco saying, okay, well, our negotiators are in Copenhagen, but you're here. Your offices are here, so we want to show you that we're counting on your action. So I think, you know, those are two points that I think are really moving. But, you know, there's no question that there's a lot of discouraging news. But I think if folks in the room and listening want to kind of stay up to date with Copenhagen, there's a lot of great resources. At 350.org, we're going to be posting a lot of content and photos about the actions that are happening. There's also, if you want to kind of follow the perspective of the youth climate movement, it's gettinghotinhere.org is the blog of the International Youth Climate Movement, and that's going to be covering Copenhagen. So if folks want to stay tuned and see kind of the inspiration perspective and the really bold perspective, I would refer folks to those places.
And if you want to go somewhere in person and watch live feeds of Copenhagen news on flat-screen TVs at the Crocker Galleria on Sutter Street, David Pascal, who was just formerly the clean tech officer for the city of San Francisco, is opening a thing called the Copenhagen Cafe, and it's going to be a place for the media to congregate, for folks who are interested to congregate, and be, you know, basically filtering all the content of all the, we probably have more advocates per capita coming from the Bay Area than nearly any other place in the world that are going to be at Copenhagen, and so he's linking up all of their content coming back, and kind of giving folks a real perspective of what's there, so I know my boyfriend will probably be there when I'm over there. He can see what I'm doing, and you guys should all come too. So we can try to send that out later to folks after the session.
Great, thank you. We've got a second question from the audience. Again, you're listening to the Commonwealth Clubs in Forum with our Millennial Changemakers, Erica Fernandez, Rachel Barge, and May Boeve.
I think some of us who have seen previous protest movements, I think the reason we don't sense that anger or what seems to us like radicalism is there seems to be a lot of confidence among younger people. I know there isn't much time, but the feeling is we're either going to get this real soon or pretty soon. You know, we're going to come through and get what we're looking for. So how do you each see the next 3 to 5 years playing out?
I can try and touch on this. I think you're right. I think we're on the verge of a lot of changes happening that we've all been advocating for. So that's encouraging. I think we're going to see a lot more from a movement perspective, which is sort of more where I see myself. I think there's going to be even more collaboration, even more of these kind of unlikely alliances happening. I think one of the things that's emerging is, you know, faith groups and labor groups and human rights groups all working together to kind of unify their movements. So I think we're going to begin to see even more kind of broad-based action happening, which I think is encouraging. And I think we're going to see, you know, here in the U.S., these tens of thousands of young people who've gone to all these trainings and made their campuses carbon neutral, running companies and running for elected office and embodying the spirit of, you know, the kind of the 21st century ideas that Rachel was talking about. But they're going to be the ones who are even more running the show. And so that is going to be really interesting, I think, and exciting. So those are two things that I see coming down the pipeline.
Yeah, I think, again, there tends to be a focus that, you know, the UN negotiations are the end-all be-all of whether or not we're going to solve climate change in the world. And I think that's sort of a narrow way to look at it. I think that a lot of countries are coming forward and making individual nationalistic commitments that are sort of outside of the UN framework. I think that, you know, there is funding going to, you know, clean energy technologies that we really have no idea in terms of their power to sort of switch over, you know, our energy systems and to decarbonize our economy. And a lot of this is, you know, are things that we really can't predict. But again, I am hopeful that some of these less sort of focused on areas of progress that aren't really held up quite so much are going to, you know, continue to play their part. You know, again, I'm working now with the Business Council on Climate Change. It's 100 companies in the Bay Area that are committed to taking climate action in their company, you know, in everything through their supply chain to how they treat their employees to, you know, their products. We just had a new member join today, Alphabet Energy. They capture waste heat and turn it into electricity, and if their technology was implemented across the U.S., they could cut our they could take 20% of our electricity grid away from coal and just capture waste heat. You know, and that's just a single company with a single technology. It's very affordable and cheap. It came out of LBNL. Like, when I hear stories like that, I get excited because, again, we're not focusing on, you know, sort of what are these. I'm not saying there's like going to be a spray of silver bullets coming at us to fix this problem, but there are a lot of private sector solutions, innovative solutions that are not just about making a target that everyone's supposed to reach. So that's, I think, another player to think about.
I think something that I would like to add is there was a couple of months ago, I went to another environmental conference, and one of the speakers was talking about genetic modified organisms and how we need to stop them to in order to have healthy lives. And I remember he mentioned something. He said, I don't want to do this for the rest of my life. I would like to be able to move up and try to stop these things that are affecting you. And I feel that one of the things that I would like to see is the glaciers to be stay up. I feel that we can save and conserve the animals that are in danger. I feel things that you want to see that you don't want them to go away. I feel that I want the people in a couple of years to be conscious and to and for the government to start putting the people in a balance higher than the money, where they start making decisions around the people and not how much money I'm going to have for the country. I feel that I want to see that where the youth are in front of decisions making, of policy making, whether you are focusing on things that are gonna affect their future, but in a positive way. I feel that, I think now it feels that overwhelmingly we have to save the planet, but in reality we should have a time where we are actually enjoying what we have and conserving what we have and not actually thinking that we're gonna lose it because of the responsibility of us using more than what we needed. I feel that once we have a conscious nation, a conscious world where we realize that our decisions and our actions might affect us all, we need to start making that, buying less, consuming less, and actually using what we have for a better place. I feel I would like to see that. I would like to see the youth being able to focus in school and to actually learn than to think that there is crime, that their families are back home because they don't have something to eat, or because my mom is sick and she doesn't have insurance, or things that are affecting them and the environmental justice that they're living every day. I would like to see a place where people can actually be happy and not having to worry that the politician in the White House or in the Senate or whatever is has their future in their hands and by signing a piece of paper or not. I would like to see justice happening, not only in the United States, but in the world when it comes to environmental justice.
I want to ask you guys a final question as we wrap up here, so I don't see any other questions from the audience. I think the gentleman made a really great point that you, this movement in general, but you guys in particular, have a lot of confidence. And you know, there's this sense that, well, youth activism is can be a you know, sort of a passing fad or just sort of a life stage, but you guys all seem like you're very much in it to win it. So I want to know where each of you see yourselves in 3 to 5 years, and just take a minute to, and literally a minute, to tell each of us where you expect to see yourselves in 3 to 5 years. With your hazy crystal ball. I know that the crystal ball is hazy with greenhouse gas emissions, but.
I'm just gonna say, I see myself mobilizing people, but I would like to summarize it in the quote of my role model, Cesar Chavez, because I wanna see myself doing that. And the quote says, once social change begins, it cannot be reversed. You cannot uneducate the person who has learned to read. You cannot humiliate the person who feels pride. And you cannot oppress the people who are not afraid anymore. We are the future, and the future is ours. And si se puede. So that's how I see myself in the future.
Gosh, 3 to 5 years is a much longer commitment than I would be comfortable making for any job or any other sort of thing in my life. But this is my life's work. This is my passion, you know, and we're not going to solve the climate crisis tomorrow or in 3 years or 5 years, I don't think. We're going to continue to build solutions for a green economy. We're going to continue to transition our society to being a sustainable society. You know, I hope that my kids or, you know, at least my grandkids are going to grow up in a world where to them, the idea that you throw away most of what, you know, you buy and you put it in the ground and you just hope that it stays there and just sort of goes away and that doesn't come back to haunt you, that seems just ludicrous. You know, that was like the, you know, that's absolutely the cultural norm today. It's just, you know, buy, consume, package, throw away. So I think, you know, this work will never be done in my lifetime, because there's always going to be ways to, you know, again, improve sustainability, and then that improves people's quality of life. Erica's talking about communities that are not going to have to struggle with asthma. They're not going to have to struggle with, you know, having food deserts where they live. They're not going to have to struggle with a lifetime of obesity because of those products. So I think, you know, across the board, any young person who wants to be passionate and it goes down the rabbit hole of getting involved, they have their life's work cut out for them. So whatever that manifests for me personally, I don't know. I'm excited to be getting private sector skills and exposure, because I think that's a big area that, you know, we need progressive people going in and helping run these companies and helping them transition. But I could, you know, the future is literally my oyster. That's what I like to say, to quote my, you know, Sarah Palin, literally my oyster.
And May, how about you?
Well, I don't really know either, but I hope that I'm pretty confident that I'll be working with Rachel and Eric and a lot of other young people in 5 years. I think looking back to 5 years ago for me seems like a long time, which it really wasn't. But I think that I've had so many opportunities to get to follow this issue and learn, meet so many people and hear so many different perspectives. So 5 years seems like an amazing amount of things could happen, and it's not, I think, crazy to believe that things really could be quite different, actually, in the way we're approaching this issue, because it has changed a lot in the last 5 years. So, but I feel pretty confident that this movement that we were all so intent on building is going to be still around, and we're going to still be working together. And I that is something I'm pretty confident about. But maybe I'll be living in Addis Ababa. Who knows?
Well, thank you all. Doesn't it feel good to be in the know? Let's give a big hand to our Millennial Changemakers for their thoughts here tonight. Now this meeting of InForum and the Commonwealth Club is adjourned. Thank you for coming.